Very happy to present the 11th edition of Kanga and Palkhiwala. This is the 70th year of this book's existence, and also happens to be, by a coincidence, the 100th birth anniversary of late Nani Palkhiwala. The book was published in 1950, but Nani Palkhiwala started writing it in March 1947, and it took 3 years to write. Not many people know that his younger brother, Bairam Palkhiwala, typed out the entire manuscript. Those were the days of the manual typewriter, where a single error meant that you had to retype the page. The book was published in September, October 1950. And it is very remarkable that in the foreword, Sir Jamshedji Kanga records that the writing was done by his co-author, which was young Nani Palkhiwala. And his role was supervisory. It was really a gracious tribute to be given by a magnanimous senior. Palkhiwala joined the bar in 1944. So when he started writing this book, he was just 3 years in the bar. And when it was published, he had 6 years of practice. The book initially had a turbulent start. In 1951, Sampath Iyengar, who had written another commentary on the income tax, filed a suit in the Madras High Court alleging that Kanga and Palkhiwala had copied several passages from his book, and he wanted an injunction against the publication and sale of this book. So Jamshedji Kanga was the first defendant, Nani Palkhiwala was the second defendant, and the publisher N.M. Tripathi was the third defendant. The details of the trial, I have set them out in the book, The Courtroom Genius, but it shows that it was a very, very bitterly fought trial, and the judgment runs into more than 200 pages. And finally, the suit was dismissed, and the judge, Justice A.S.P. Iyer of the Madras High Court, recorded that Palkhiwala had not plagiarized or not copied extracts from Sampath Iyengar's book. In fact, he had done his own research and written his book. So after this turbulent start, there was no looking back, and the book went from strength to strength. And as you know, it has been cited in numerous judgments, not only in India, but overseas as well. My team and I started editing the 10th edition in 2005 or 6, and we published the 10th edition in 2014, and the 11th edition has now been published on the 70th anniversary of the book. I must mention that from the first edition and the early editions, there were a number of other contributors, some of whom have been kind enough to give interviews or give recordings of what work they did. It's only now that we realize how difficult a task it was in those days to not only write the book, but also revise the book. There were no computers, there was no software, there was no word processing. So even in the 80s, when I wrote my excise book, the earlier edition would come on a big white sheet of paper, and on half size, they would paste the earlier edition's page, and on the right hand side, you made your corrections. This paper would then go to the, would be typed, sent to the printer, composed, proofread, and then printed. It was quite a laborious and tedious process. Palkhiwala has himself acknowledged the work of several people in the writing of his book. Apart from Mr. Dilip Choksi, Mr. H.P. Ranina, Mr. Dinesh Vyas and others, he also acknowledged the help of Shirin Barucha, who at that time was in charge of all the company work in, of the Tatas, but helped Nani Palkhiwala in proofreading the manuscript and the typescript. Now, as you know, proofreading is an extremely difficult and laborious task. It has to be done with great accuracy. And despite all our efforts, it is really sometimes depressing to see small printing errors come despite it being proofread 3-4 times. And I must tell you that as long as Palkhivala was alive, it was his boast and it was absolute truth that the book did not contain a single error. That was the quality of the book. Of course, today we can't make the same claim. We have tried to keep the errors to the minimum. But now that the 11th edition is out, we are very happy that we tried our best to do justice to the memory of Nani Palkhivala, Bairam Palkhivala, and of course, Sir Jamshedji Kanga. It was Bairam Palkhivala's wish that the book remains in 2 volumes, but I'm afraid that from the 12th edition, we will have to go to 3 volumes because it is becoming difficult to bind the contents of this book. Bairam Palkhivala would give up several months of his practice to write the book, and he would do the notes along with Mr. Ranina in some of the editions, and Mr. Palkhivala would do the final corrections, and the book would be published.
Sir Jamshedji Kanga was an additional judge of the Bombay High Court, and later he returned to practice. Was this an accepted practice?
Yes, absolutely. In the old days it was. And in fact, he was a judge and quite a distinguished judge, because in 3 major cases of his, where sitting singly, he decided a case in a particular way, laying down the law, which was reversed by the division bench of 2 judges. But when it went to the Privy Council, because then in those days the appeals used to go to the Privy Council, the Privy Council restored the judgment of Sir Jamshedji Kanga and reversed the division bench. So he had that to his credit. And after he demitted office as an additional judge, he stepped down and became the Advocate General for 12 long years.
And in Roses in December, Justice M.C. Chawla contrasts the advocacy style of Sir Jamshedji Kanga with Motilal Sitalwar. Do you have any recollection of Sir Jamshedji Kanga's style of advocacy which could be useful to younger members?
Oh yes, of course. In fact, you see, I joined Sir Jamshedji Kanga's chambers in 1951. That is the year after the constitution. The year after the first edition of Kanga and Palkhivala was published. And we youngsters, there were many of us, there was just no room in the chamber for us to have neither a table nor even a chair. And the seniors had a table with chairs opposite, which sometimes we utilized when clients were not present. The junior seniors, which included Mr. Baba, Mr. Palkhivala, Mr. Vimadalal on the other side, had only one chair where the solicitor would sit and the client would stand. So it was a peculiar system. But let me just read to you what his finest junior, Mr. H.M. Sidwai, a great constitutional lawyer, said when Jamshedji died at the age, ripe old age of 95, and there was a reference in the High Court. He described the atmosphere of this chamber of Sir Jamshedji's, where I had the honor to be right from 1951 right up to 1972 when I moved to Delhi. Just let me read that to you, but first let me show you, or your readers, or your listeners rather, a picture of Sir Jamshedji, because not many of them have any idea of what he looked like. This is what he looked like. He always wore, he was a priest by profession. He came very late to the bar. And in fact, at about 28, at age 28, whereas we were all youngsters who came in before we were 21. This was him. He always wore this cap, the priest's cap, in court, when he appeared in court. But in obedience to his mother, although he smoked, and priests don't smoke, Parsi priests, but he smoked. And he never wore the cap when he smoked, and he never smoked in the home. You see, he was a great traditionalist, apart from being one of the humblest of men. He was a giant in the law, but one of the humblest of men. And all 6 feet 4 inches of him, 6 feet 4, this was his height. And he was a remarkable person. His memory was absolutely tremendous. He could recite 100,000 lines of Shahnama, the great Persian poet, by rote. And he remembered all those lines. And when, before he died, some solicitor went to see him 4 months before and found him reciting to himself Milton's Paradise Lost. Now, Milton's Paradise Lost is an enormous epic, not just a poem, it's epic. So the solicitor, poor fellow, asked him, he said, "Sir Jamsetji, where did you learn this?" And he was quite angry. He said, "It was the prescribed text in my college." And that was 75 years ago, 75 or 80 years ago. Remarkable man. But he was as humble as he was remarkable or a giant. In fact, I don't know if people who read your book, Kanga and Palkiwala, because this is in honor of that book, he had written in the very first edition of that book something which your readers must know. He said, in a book which cites thousands of authorities, I may be pardoned for relying on one more in the foreword. He wrote a foreword in the 1950 first edition. Justice Holmes, the great American judge, observed, and he quotes, "The riders in a race do not stop short when they reach the goal. There is a little finishing canter before coming to a standstill. The race is over, but the work is never done while the power to work remains." It was in this spirit that I agreed to associate myself with this book. And now comes the humble part. My task has been mainly of a supervisory and advisory character. The actual writing has been done by my co-author, signed J.B. Kanga. Who would write this? When he was at the zenith of peak of his career, and I had seen him after I came in 1951 on the rare occasions when he would appear in court. There was a reference once in the Chagla's court. Chagla was Chief Justice. And Chagla inevitably sat with income tax references with Justice Tendulkar, another very clever judge. And there was a case, and Kanga was just waiting for his case to reach. And in that particular case which was going on, the judges found that there was an absurd question of law which was not properly argued by either on one side or the other. Chagla saw Jamsetji and he said, "Brother, let's ask Kanga." So, and it is rarely done, nobody ever does that. And he asked Jamsetji, he put the point to him. And Jamsetji, with his huge arms, said, expounded on it without reference to who would benefit by it, neither the assessee or the commissioner. He was not bothered. He gave a completely honorable and honest answer. I mean, that was his humility, and he was the humblest of men. And there I must also, just one more thing which I must do, you can then ask your question, that the atmosphere of this chamber of his was something remarkable. And it was best described by this very gentleman, Sirvai, who became Advocate General for 16 long years, not 12, but 16. At the time of the reference, he was by then, when Kanga died at 95, there was a reference in court. The court was closed in honor of his memory, and this is what he said. The chambers had an extraordinary atmosphere. If you did not want to work or wanted to chat or gossip about the share bazaar or about current gossip, you were free to do so. But if you are willing to work, he was extremely generous. He's talking about Kanga. He acknowledged both to solicitor and to court the debt which he owed to his juniors. The long years of waiting at the bar. You remember I told you he came in the bar at 27. Would have been unendurable but for his nature, which radiated vitality and charm. In his room, there was always sunshine. Beautiful. In his room, there was always sunshine. He delighted in the success of his juniors, though he modestly put it down to his chamber being a lucky chamber. But they knew better. To them, he was both an example and an inspiration. Unspoiled by success, modest and unassuming in manner, retaining in spite of all his great powers, the simplicity and candor of a child. He was childlike, never childish. That's what he meant. This was Sirvey about him. And I think this sums up the whole, the whole association that we, all of us, had with him. We adored him.
And did Sir Jamshedji Kanga appear in the Supreme Court?
No. In the Federal Court, yes. That is, there was a brief time when, from 1937, to 1950, there was in India established by the British a federal court in which appeals went, and from the federal court to the Privy Council. So he appeared, I think, once or twice at the most. But he was almost stuck in Bombay.
Although Sir Jamshedji Kanga was the head of the chamber, each member seems to have had his own practice.
Oh, absolutely.
Would solicitors brief any counsel without engaging certain...
Oh, yes, yes, absolutely, absolutely. Because each one had his own separate practice. But I had the distinction, I was very young then, I had the distinction of appearing last with him, his last appearance, where he didn't lead me, but I led him, which was remarkable. It happened like this, that he had a client who was 40 years his client, and he wanted Sir Jamshedji to appear. But Sir Jamshedji said, you know I can't read. You see, he had a booming voice. And so, but he said, no, no, sir, you kiss it, we will brief Nariman. So Nariman happened to be briefed. I was a raw junior. And this was his last appearance. And as the matter went on, and with his luck, we actually won. He would whisper to me in Gujarati, "Kitli maja parej." That means, what fun this is. Because he recollected his own days when he was the arguer in court. Remarkable man.
Sir Jamshedji Kanga was 75 when you joined the bar.
That's right.
What were his hobbies or interests outside of law?
As I said, his hobby or interest was his memory for things that he had learnt in college. I gave you the example of Milton's Paradise Lost, of the Shahnama. But that amused him and kept him alive. Not only alive, it kept him as alive as all of us, who were much more alive. But you see, he had a failing eyesight, but not a failing memory. That was his, because he had a searchlight like this behind him to read, because he otherwise couldn't read at all. He operated on one eye virtually in court when in his heyday, and he was a remarkable person. Remarkable. There's no one like him.
And would Nani Palkhivala and other juniors, including yourself, consult him on important cases?
Oh yes, yes, yes. We'd all. But apart from consulting him, we'd ask his views on, because he knew, his memory was so sharp, that he could visualize something that we had found difficulty with, and he would come up with some solution. He was a great solver, a problem solver. And of course, in the chamber, it was a regular chamber where the seniors and the senior juniors would all assemble at after 6:30 for either stories or some gossip, or as Silvia said, some gossip or the other. And at that point of time, he would recollect certain things. And he could recollect something that was reported in a case book, that is to say, in a law report, with reference to the page, and he would say, this is written on the left-hand side and not on the right-hand side. So astute was his memory.
And how did he spend his last days?
You see, he remained in court, and that's another last story which I'll tell you. In the old chambers, which we are on the ground floor, there were chambers of various councils. Sir Nashirwan Engineer, YB Adege, a lot of them. They were all asked to leave when the court needed all these premises for more courts. So, with some reluctance, Sir Jamsetji headed a delegation of all senior lawyers, not me, I was too junior then, to go to the Chief Justice, who was Chagla, and to say that some accommodation should be found for them. Chagla said, no, it's not possible at all. So Sir Jamsetji said, in his booming voice, he said, in that case, my lord, I will have to sit at home. But he said, why? Why, Sir Jamsetji? Chagla had a peculiar fascination for Sir. He said, if I don't sit in court in my chamber, I have to sit at home. That's what he was pontificating. That irked Chagla. Do you know, within a year, when we all had to leave, he had the next door premises, next to the High Court, an additional floor put. It wasn't the court. And with access to the court, only because of Sir Jamsetji. And there we shifted. When we shifted, we had this the largest possible chamber on that floor, chamber number one. And that was the affection which Chagla had for Sir Jamsetji.
And you mentioned that Chagla had a peculiar fascination.
Yes, and the reason was this. There was a reason which we at that time didn't know, but which we now do. You see, Chagla's father was a litigant of some sort. He had a litigation. And there was need for some senior counsel for that litigation. So Chagla first mentioned to his own senior, who was M.A. Jinnah, the great Mr. Jinnah. And he offered the brief. But Jinnah looked at the brief and saw the fees are not marked. He says, you know that I never appear without fees. So Chagla, poor fellow, at that time the Chagla family couldn't afford the fees. So they were not high, but still high by those standards, yes. Even if they were 10 gold mohs, they were high. 150 rupees was high. So at that time, Sir Jamsetji was Advocate General. So he marched up to the Advocate General. He took it in his stride. He said, yes, of course I'll appear. And Chagla never forgot that. That's how their relationship was.
And how much time did you spend in that chamber?
Oh dear, they're from 51 to 72, when I was appointed Additional Solicitor General of India, so I had to shift to Delhi. That's all. It was the most glorious time of mine, was in that chamber.
Hello everyone, I am Jahangir Palkhewala, who is the son of B.A. Palkhewala, Bairam Palkhewala, who is the brother of N.A. Palkhewala. And these two brothers, about 70 years ago, decided to come out with a book on the practice of income tax and the laws of income tax And they decided to give birth to a book which was not in existence before. So they worked very hard to make sure that it came into existence in a form that they would like. How hard they worked and the labor pains that they went through, many people don't know about. And I can only really speak about my father, though I'm sure my uncle worked extremely hard as well. So Arvind Bhai Datar, who has come out with the last edition and the one that's just come out, so he was very sweet. He suggested that we put together memories of people who were close to my dad and my uncle and what they saw that went into the creation of this child, this baby, which was by all accounts rather exceptional. So some memories that I have are that my father, unlike what people do today, had to type physically every single page that became the book. And it wasn't one typing. He would send the typewritten document to the printers. The printers would send it back. There would be errors. He would correct the errors. There would be fresh errors. He would get a little frustrated and correct those fresh errors. And it went back and forth so that each page was probably typed more than once. And to think that one man actually typed every single page in that book more than once with every new edition also is quite something. So he learned all about block printing and all that to make sure that he knew why there were errors and how he could sort them out and that sort of thing. No computers at that time at all. So one thing that I noticed, which was quite remarkable, is that when I came into this room, this is the room in which my dad did all his work. And right here behind me, you can see the first edition up to the 8th. And then there's a 9th edition. There's a 10th edition that is in another bookcase because there's no place for that one here. And you could see my uncle Nani Palkhivala's photos here and a plaque that he was given. The photo has faded, so you can't see this one very well on a silver plaque, on a silver tray. So he had this amazing capacity of being so extremely focused on his work that when I came into this room where he worked, he actually would not know that I had come in. I could even be saying something and saying, you know, the newspaper man has come, shall we give him the money for the month? And I would speak for maybe half a minute and he would just be pouring his mind into the book or into the manuscripts that he was working on, and he wouldn't know that I'd come. So if I said, Dad, a little loudly, he would say, huh, so thayo? Ah, dikra, tu ayo, kore ayo? When did you come? What happened? He was completely oblivious of what was happening in his even immediate surroundings, even just 7 feet away, 10 feet away, he would not know even when somebody was speaking to him. He had that kind of focus. Not only was he focused like that when he was at work, but he was at work a ridiculous number of hours. So when we talk about labor pains, people have them for a couple of days, but he used to work for like 19 to 21 hours. I know that sounds impossible, but after one edition was over and I asked him that, Dad, is it true really that you work 19 to 21 hours every day for these 6 months? So he said, yes, sometimes 22 hours. So it was a little extreme the way he would come for lunch and hardly even notice us sitting around him. He would just say something like, Barabasha, everything all right? Eat in 5 minutes and leave. And similarly, dinner. And very often he wouldn't even come unless he was called. Food didn't seem to make much difference when he was working. He was just working with all his mind in the work. So sometimes he would work like that, finish his lunch, dinner, say bye, go away, work till 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock. And then finally, maybe at 3, he would wipe his eyes, wrap up everything, get into bed at 3:30 maybe, and be up at 6 working again, sometimes up at 5 working again. So it seemed a little inhuman, and I suppose it was. And it took its toll on his body also, because sitting for so long, for 6 months and sometimes more, each time a new edition came out, was a lot for the body to take. So actually he started getting a hernia and he had to be operated because he was sitting so many hours with his intestines pressing downwards against his peritoneum that it actually was damaging for his body without his realizing it. But even if he realized it, I don't think that would have made any difference, because when he put his mind to something, he put all his mind into it. He was rather an extremist as far as work is concerned. So for him, work was God. And I remember asking him once, we would chat about all sorts of things as a family. So I once asked him, Dad, what's your definition of God? And he just took a moment, thought, and then said, a prompt, punctual, perfect worker. Now, that won't be many people's definition of God, but it was his. And he said specifically that the way I would like to die, he was my dad, Bairam Palkhivala, was talking about himself when he said, the way he would like to die is in the saddle. He said, I would love to die right here in this chair, working on whatever I'm working on, and then leave my body. We used to be a part of this process also and see how he would work also. But obviously we were not awake at night when he went to bed, nor were we awake in the morning when he woke up to carry on with his work. But we helped him with proofreading. And there was a time, maybe in my later school days before I entered college, when he would ask me to proofread. He would ask my elder brother also, Adil, and my younger brother, Firoz, also to proofread. But I do remember when I was proofreading that he at one stage liked my pronunciation very much. So he would say, Kyu saras vachech, you're reading so well. Your lips move like Richard Burton's lips. So that was the ultimate compliment for Dad, because his idea of perfect speech was Richard Burton. And so I didn't realize that it was such a big compliment till later on when my speech became not so good at all, when I entered Elphinstone College and it became very free-flowing. And he was pretty upset. He said, what a way you used to read. Why don't you read like that anymore? And he devised all sorts of ways in which there would be no misinterpretation while we were reading the old proofs. And he would read the corrected version and make sure that there was not a single comma or any kind of error. So, for example, he would say, don't say 40. Because it can mean 40 or 14 if I don't hear you correctly. So whenever it's 1-4, say 14, but when it's 4-0, say 4-tai. So whether it was Adil or me or Firoz, we would always be saying 5-tai for 5-0 and 7-tai for 7-0 and 17 only for 1-7. He developed several things like that to completely eliminate any possibility of error. He was so extreme with that, that when one edition was published and he got a letter, at that time no emails, he got a letter saying that I have heard that your book does not have a single comma or full stop out of place. Everything is perfect. I am a gentleman from Switzerland. This was a man who wrote to Dad a letter saying, I'm a gentleman from Switzerland. I've gone through your book and I have found that there is one comma out of place. It should not have been here. It should be here. And I remember Dad being completely perturbed. He would have seen that somebody had shot his son. But it was just a comma that he was told was out of place. So he had gone right through all the records that he had. He went to the book. He found the page that the person was referring to. And he came back looking very happy, relieved and smiling. And he said, the poor fellow, he doesn't know his grammar. The comma is perfectly in place. It should be exactly where it was. So he was more than just an ordinary perfectionist. He was the perfectionist's perfectionist.
One of the greatest privileges in life has been the opportunity to participate along with Nani Sahib and Bairam Sahib in compilation of the 8th edition of Law and Practice of Income Tax, which was probably the last edition that they themselves had penned. The enormity of that great opportunity was realized when Shirin Bharucha and I were proofreading. Nani Sahib would come and meet us often to ensure that everything was going without any problems. It was then that I realized that Nani Sahib took great pride in the fact that the House of Lords had referred to his contribution to the subject and referred to his book in one of their judgments. In the history of the House of Lords, they have done that only twice or thrice, and Nani Sahib's reference was one of them. This was the great detail to which everything was worked where Nani Sahib is concerned, not only in the contents, but also in the preparation of the book. In order to ensure that it did not exceed the size that he desired, the entire book would be put into huge sheets of paper on which the manuscript would be stuck. These would be updated by Bairam Sahib with every important case law and every important legislation put in with the briefest of words to ensure that the page numbers do not get exceeded. These were then seen by Nani Sahib personally before they went into print and the proof was prepared. Not only that, attention was also paid to the quality of the paper and the size of the font. The paper had to last for a long period of time. The book had to be of a convenient size that would enable counsel to refer to the book while arguing before court, and the font had to be of a size that did not make it a strain to read.
There was a comment made in a review to the 7th edition that the law and practice of income tax covered subjects which were decided by courts. In short, there was no commentary on a subject which was not covered by a case law. This was valid criticism which was well received by Mr. Palkhivala. It was therefore decided that subsequently he would give his comments even on new provisions of the income tax law introduced by a Finance Act. This would ensure that when a judge in future was giving its interpretation on this new provision, they would certainly take into account the views and the commentary of Mr. Palkhivala. And in that sense, the case law would develop and the law and practice of income tax would then add to the tax jurisprudence of India.
Every time I write, whether it be on tax or constitutional law or any other topic that I write about, not necessarily law also, the gold standard that I try to achieve is the clarity and the economy of expression that Sri Nani Palkhivala was able to achieve. So when I was editing this 11th edition of Kangan Palkhivala, that was what was running in my mind throughout, that I must write in a way that it reminds people of Nani Palkhivala. It's an extremely difficult place to reach, but that was the endeavor. I learned tax by reading the 8th and 9th editions of Kangan Palkhivala when I was in college. I was always very interested in tax, and so I would spend my spare time in my 4th and 5th years reading random pages from the 8th and 9th editions. And the beauty and the simplicity with which the concepts were put across left a lasting impression on how I thought about the Income Tax Act itself. So when I started working on the 10th and now the 11th edition of Kangan Palkhivala, it felt like I was working with my gurus, the people who taught me tax, that is Kangan Palkhivala. And of course, the chief editor of these two editions was my actual tax guru, Arvind Attar, senior advocate, with whom I worked for almost 5 years in his chamber. And in 2014, when I left his chamber, Kangan Palkhivala was the bond that kept us going, and it ensured that we always stayed in touch. I mean, I do work with him on a lot of cases and opinions, but Kangan Palkhivala was that special bond between the two of us.
I had interned with Mr. Dattar while I was in law school, and it was in that internship that my interest in tax law initially started. Since then, I have had the chance to work with Mr. Dattar on a few matters, and it has always been a great experience working with him. Therefore, I was thrilled to have gotten the opportunity to work with him under his guidance for the newest edition of Kangan Palkhivala.
I started assisting Mr. Dattar in 2007 on the 10th edition as a law student. I immediately wrote to him the moment it came to my knowledge that he is editing the next edition of Kangan Palkhivala, and I did not want to miss out on that opportunity. I was initially asked to prepare case notes for small chapters. Mr. Datar not only taught us as to how to make precise and perceptive case notes, but he also engaged in discussion with us to ensure that he gets the better out of us. As time progressed, I was completely dedicated to the 10th edition, and he was kind enough to entrust the task of coordinating with all the contributors and the publisher. With regard to the 11th edition, me and my colleagues, Mihir, Swaroop, and myself are grateful to Mr. Datar, who without an iota of doubt handed over the entire responsibility of preparing the initial manuscripts to us. We discussed among ourselves many chapters of the book and tried to explain few commentaries in the more erudite manner. In the present edition, my key contribution is non-resident taxation, double non-taxation, general anti-avoidance rules, and the hotly debated equalization levy. The present edition also comes in an electronic form. The readers can make annotations, mark and highlight passages of the book, and also print and extract passages from the book. These tools will definitely be handy for a busy tax professional.
So I have great pleasure in presenting this book to all of you, and I hope that this book sees many more editions to come in the years ahead. On behalf of my colleagues, I must thank Fali Nariman for giving us an interview of his association with Sir Jamshedji Kanga and of course Nani Palkhiwala and all the other earlier contributors that make this book possible. As you know, this book, any book of this size, is always a very, very big collaborative effort, and it's only the cooperation, contribution, dedication of the entire team that makes this book possible.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel and click the bell icon.